If I told you one man saved a kit model company, your first guess would be that he was some clever new company president or perhaps a white knight investor. It is unlikely that you would guess he was an industrial designer, fine artist, and kit designer, but he was. The now legendary Tom Daniel came to Monogram at just the right time and with just the right abilities to help pull them out of a serious financial rut following the near collapse of the slot car market. According to Monogram kit engineer Ken Merker, the Daniels designs may have kept Monogram alive. At a minimum, the late shop supervisor, Roger Harney, credited them with yanking Monogram out of the post-slot car slump. In fact, according to Thomas Graham's book on Monogram models, at one point, the Tom Daniel designed kits represented over 40% of the company's income, with the Red Baron car alone selling over 3 million units in just 2 years. I can personally recall seeing them on the shelves for years. I wanted one, but my fascination with airplanes and armor usually won the battle for my $1 a week allowance. So who is Tom Daniel, and what makes him so special? Well, I can oversimplify that answer in 6 words. Right person, right time, right attitude. Now let's break that down a bit more, and then we can talk about the kits. Tom Daniel, many just call him TD, was raised in East Los Angeles, California during the Depression. Living through such hard times gave him a strong sense of what's important and what's not. And this is going to be very important later. He learned at an early age that he could draw very well, and the things we're good at often develop into our interests. From grammar school through high school, he was a straight-A art student and won countless awards and competitions, including the prestigious Bullock's Gold Key Award for high school achievement in art. Following high school graduation in 1954, Daniel was accepted as a freshman to a very prestigious art school, the Art Center School, then in West Los Angeles. Tom began a brutal regime, 6 days a week, for 4 years. His talent was spotted by Charles Chuck Jordan, who, at the time, was the chief designer in the Cadillac studio at the GM Technical Center north of Detroit, Michigan. Chuck Jordan interviewed Tom at the Art Center campus on 3rd Street in West Los Angeles just prior to his graduation in 1959. With a BPA degree, Tom was off to Detroit to work at GM Styling in the Advanced Truck Studio. His stint there would be a productive one. But then a problem arose, one that no one could have foreseen. Some idiot got the bright idea to stick nuclear missiles in Cuba, and since Tom was already an active Naval Air Reservist, well, as the old military song goes, when the crap hits the fan, call out the friggin' reserves. Okay, it doesn't exactly go just like that, but I want to keep this family friendly. At the time of the Cuban Missile Crisis, Tom was called to active service with VS 772, an anti-submarine squadron, and flew Grumman S-2Fs as a madman or magnetic airborne detection and ECM electronic countermeasures operator. He earned his gold aircrew wings prior to being mustered out at the end of the crisis, and after nearly a year on active duty. Following his honorable discharge, he returned to work back in sunny California, this time with North American Aviation in Downey on the Apollo Moon Project. It wasn't long before Chuck Jordan of General Motors came back trying to recover his former employee, but for a litany of personal reasons, Tom decided to stay in California. And on a personal note, having been through a Midwestern winter myself, I can easily understand someone's desire to remain in sunny Southern California. In addition to his regular work, Tom had established a relationship with Peterson Publications, as well as being a contributor to numerous magazines, especially ones dealing with cars and hot rods. He had even done a box illustration for Revell Models 57 Chevy, kit number H1284. So the kit model world was part of Tom's universe. This got his creative juices flowing in the direction of kit models, and he'd already been developing the idea of an old coal scuttle German helmet to be grafted onto a T-bucket hot rod, This was around 1963. As the 1960s progressed, various model companies were making caricature models like Hawk's Weirdos and Aurora's Woozies. Revell was watching, and in 1969 introduced the first of its Deals wheels, but I'm getting ahead of myself. Let me back up just a bit. Monogram saw itself as a serious model company, but they were also very in tune with the changes in the industry. Models tend to have a roughly 5 to 10 year long cycle where one type of kit tends to command the market. Up until now, it had mostly rotated between factory cars, aircraft, military, then space and science fiction. From whatever was in the media and movies to what was at the car shows was used to help aim young model builders' selections. Modelers were always looking for the next thing, and you can only build so many 55 Chevys, P-51 Mustangs, and B-17s before the ceiling and shelves look like a post-war aircraft dump or a used car lot. Not that that's a bad thing, mind you. Robert Reeder at Monogram was aware of this and was already trying to figure out how to approach the current situation when he got an unsolicited letter from Tom Daniel. Now, there's nothing new about model companies getting offers of help from builders and wannabe model makers, but this was different. Reeder somehow recognized there was something to this one and asked Roger Harney about it. Harney was familiar with Daniel's work, and the rest pretty much flowed naturally. There was a formula for kit model success in the late 60s and early 70s, and it involved a blend of what was happening in the real world of hot rod and custom car makers. They were getting really creative just as an older generation of kids were starting to hit what we might call reality modeling fatigue, and younger kids with no built-in love of militaria were starting to buy models. Now add the business acumen of Bob Reeder at Monogram, and you have a good base, but you still need that secret sauce. And that sauce is the insanely gifted Tom Daniel. Now all you have to do is stir and leave it alone. Just let the man do his thing. And what you get are the best-selling and best-known kit models in the long history of Monogram models. This is not my opinion. This is a quantifiable fact given Monogram sales numbers. This covers the three things I mentioned about Tom Daniel's gift earlier. First, he was the right person, and that he had both the creative mind and artistic skills to make good on Monogram's goals. Secondly, he came along at just the right time in modeling history. 10 years earlier or 10 years later, and he probably would not have gotten the work. And thirdly, he had the right attitude. Now, there are two parts to that last piece. First off, he is a go-getter who did not wait around for an opportunity to rear its head. He reached out and grabbed opportunity from the shadows and dragged it into reality. Also, and this next bit gets back to his personal ethos that I mentioned earlier, he has a hard work ethic along with reasonable and balanced expectations. He made a good, solid living, but worked hard for his money, usually getting at best around $600 for each kit he developed. Now that is about $4,000 in 2020 dollars. Of course, he would have several things going at one time, and he did negotiate a small royalty per kit, but he never made ludicrous demands, and by all accounts, he never had a single squabble with Monogram over money. Between his volume of high-quality work and the success of his ideas, he had an unusually high level of freedom for a commercial engineer and artist. Bob Reeder seemed happy to let him go and do his own thing, and that level of trust in good people helps to explain Monogram's success. Daniel made a couple of visits a year to the Monogram factory and talked with the engineers. He understood their language and what could reasonably be expected of mold makers. He did not get so emotionally invested in an idea that he would have a problem if the engineers needed some changes for production reasons. In fact, by all accounts, he was quite easy to work with. Very professional. And there you have the secret sauce of Tom Daniel's successful run with Monogram from 1967 to 1975. Now, to the kits. Of course, the place to begin is with his most famous design, the Red Baron Tea Bucket. this best-known and best-selling of his designs was actually made in two scales, but it was not his first kit for Monogram. That honor goes to the beer wagon. Bob Reeder flew out from Monogram's plant in Waukegan, Illinois, to meet with Tom and visited for a couple of days. This led to his first consulting assignment, which was to hot rod an old 1920s chain drive Mack truck. This became the beer wagon, which sold well and then led to the Red Baron and, of course, a long list of other kits. In fact, I believe it was 75 kits in all. The original Red Baron kits were 1 to 24 scale, after being reduced with a pantograph from a 1 to 12 scale mold model. But eventually, Monogram took the risky decision to release them in the full 1 to 12 scale, and all of a sudden, the same basic mold model had breathed new interest into the design. One of his other great creations was the Escool Bus. He even made a garbage truck cool. A garbage truck. The idea of a garbage truck with surfboards on the side and a rock band playing off the back of it is so out there that only the mind of a genius or a madman could conceive of it. And Daniel is perfectly sane. I actually recall standing in a store staring at that kit and thinking about how much I wanted to drive something like that for real. Then there were the wagons, the paddy wagon, the pie wagon, the dragon wagon, and, being a military guy, my personal favorite, Rommel's Rod. If I try to name all of them, I'm going to be here all day, so we'll just show more of them on the outro. But I do want to cover another point. The Tom Daniel models share a certain coherence. With all of them coming from the same mind, there was a certain je ne sais quoi about them. Now don't get me wrong. Daniel was not a model snob. He had no problem with making snap-tight kits that were easier for young kids. He knew they needed to have a few successes under their belts, so they would not get discouraged if their first kits turned out to be glue bombs. This would be his Snapdragons. They were extreme and whimsical enough to keep the kids happy, as well as Monogram's overlords at Mattel Toy Company that now basically own Monogram. Tom Daniel is so associated with Monogram cars that people forget he also designed the look for the most famous of whimsical model airplanes, the Flapjack. Now, the mechanics of the model had been done before he made the look, but the look is all Tom Daniel. As an aside, despite its whimsical nature, it is not an easy kit to build and have work properly. Another thing that he never got proper credit for, and that I personally find a little bit irksome, even though I wasn't involved, is that Tom never really got the credit he deserved for designing the Munster Coach, which, by the way, is one of my favorite TV cars. And also, as Daniel called it, Dragula, the two vehicles used in the popular television show The Munsters. As part of the California car scene, he was one of several go-to guys for car ideas. The famous car promoter, George Barris, needed a car idea for a new TV show, which, as it turned out, was The Munsters, and Tom had sketches to him the next day. It was actually built by, and I hope I'm saying this right, Dick Dean Swiatskis, with help from a couple of other guys, but for whatever reason, Daniel never got credit from Barris for the design. The same would later go for the Surf Woody. Far be it for me to say someone in show business would hog the limelight, but I sure am thinking it. Now, I do not want you to think that Daniel's career somehow ended after Monogram. Quite the contrary. He continues to be a productive artist and has done box art for Revell in addition to his rather impressive experiences in the world of real cars. His Red Baron is not only still the top-selling model car ever, but is also available as a Hot Wheels car, and is the second best-selling one of those. Tom was involved with his longtime friend, the late Gary Gabelich, who was the former holder of the world land speed record of 622.407 miles per hour, set at the famed Bonneville Salt Flats near Wendover, Utah, on October 23, 1970. Gary's land speed record held for 13 years. Tom Daniel was the executive vice president of Rocketman Corporation and worked with Gary on the design of the new 800-plus mile-per-hour rocket-powered land speed record car named the American Way. Gary hoped to use it to set a new land speed record, but regrettably, in January of 1984, Tom Daniels' good friend, Gary Gabelich, was killed in a motorcycle accident near his home in Long Beach, California. The man drove a car faster than a speeding bullet, only to die in a routine traffic accident. The universe loves its brutal irony. I could go on, but we'd be here all night. I highly recommend you check out the Tom Daniel website, link below. Normally, this is where I would say something like, all good things must come to an end, but not this time. Tom Daniel is still working hard and still selling art. While it is true that modeling drifted towards new subject matter, the Daniel designs are still made. They're timeless. But what is it that makes them so special? It's not just their uniqueness. There are many unique kits that never reached out to young model builders the way the Tom Daniel designs did. There is a hard-to-define thing, a special something that words cannot quite define, that makes a thing reach out to us and lightly touch us near our hearts. It's delicate, but potent. And somehow, Tom Daniel is gifted with the ability to bring it out of the ether and into our lives. I want to extend a special thanks to Mr. Daniel for both allowing me to produce this video and for his assistance. So, what is your kit building experience with Tom Daniel Designs? As always, let's keep it civil in the comments section. And once again, I'm Max. Thanks for watching.
Ab tun jetzt ist singen wir zusammen eine Geschichte über den Schweinkopf-Hinwood und den lieben Rottenberg.
After the turn of the century, in the clear blue skies over Germany, came a roar and a thunder men had never heard, like the screaming sound of a big war bird. Up in the sky, a man in a plane, Baron von Richthofen was his name. Amen, try, and amen, die. Now they're buried together on the countryside. 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 or more, that bloody Red Baron was rolling up the score. Amen, die, trying to end that spree of the bloody Red Baron of Germany. In the nick of time, a hero arose, a funny-looking dog with a big black nose. He flew to the sky to seek revenge, but the Baron shot him down.
Hurry, the spoil began.
10, 20, 30, 40, 50 or more, that bloody Red Baron was rolling up the score. Amen, died trying to end that spree of the bloody Red Baron of Germany. Now Snoopy has sworn that he'd get that man, so he asked the great pumpkin for a new battle plan. He challenged the German to a real dog fight. While the Baron was laughing, he got him in his sight. Hang on, Snoopy, Snoopy, hang on. That bloody Red Baron was in a fix. He tried everything, but he's run out of tricks. Snoopy fired once, and he fired twice, and that bloody Red Baron went spinning out of sight. 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 or more, that bloody Red Baron was rolling up the score. Amen, died trying to end that spree of the bloody Red Baron of Germany. Well, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 or more, that bloody Red Baron was rolling up the score. Amen, died trying to end that spree of the bloody Red Baron of Germany.